Let me share with you from my heart a little bit about why I'm going to be teaching what I've been teaching. Last 3 or 4 weeks now, we've been teaching on the story of Matthew 25, the 10 virgins, right? How many understand that a little bit better now? And today I'm going to finish up that story, but as I was kind of praying about it and just asking God about what to do today, He reminded me about this verse in Ephesians 4. So turn there first, Ephesians chapter 4. And it's kind of, it's been a verse that God, a section of passage that God has put in my heart a long time ago. And to take Christians from where they're at to maybe nominal believers to actually believing. Amen. Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the church. Remember Acts chapter 2 when the Holy Spirit came down and Peter stood up and prophesied and began to preach and thousands of people got saved. The Spirit of God came on them. It says, as clothes with tongues of fire, and the Spirit came in them for the first time. And they spoke in tongues. There were different languages that were spoken. It was amazing. People that were Jewish people began to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and it was just an amazing time. And then it says, this is what the prophet Joel said. He says, in the last days I'm going to pour out my Spirit on all flesh. You know the story, right? He says, my manservants and my maidservants, all of them will begin to prophesy. And I want to reemphasize again today that word servant means something really spectacular for us that are believers, okay? Because if you study it out just a little bit, you don't have to go very far. Just go to blueletterbible.com or go to any Bible study online, a concordance, and look up that word servant. It means this. It means bond servants. And I explained that a couple weeks ago what that meant. That meant that servant was released from their master's care. And they were willing to go back and serve that master for the rest of their lives. They're now bonded to that servant freely. They didn't have to do it. It wasn't like they were in bondage. They were free to do that. Why is that so significant to me and for you today? Because we can't just serve God. We have to be bond servants. That's like we sang a song. All my life, everything that's within me, I give you everything. I surrender, right? It's all, my whole life is yours. All my thoughts, all my income, all my talents. How many real talented people here, right? All my skills, everything, right? Everything that is within me, I'm going to serve you. And then it says, you'll prophesy. Then you'll prophesy. See, when I'm totally sold out, 100% for God, then God, by His Spirit, will allow me to prophesy. Why is that important? Because prophecy is preaching. Prophecy is foretelling. Prophecy helps people understand who God is, right? I was Crystal, you know. Some people get in this prophecy mode where they want to judge the church and how bad. When you study out prophecy just for a little bit, you find out prophecy is for encouragement for the body of Christ. That's the purpose. So when somebody prophesies, they uplift the body. They encourage us to walk this walk for God. It's an amazing thing. And so I desire, my whole, with everything within me, is that we would be bondservants for Jesus. All right, why? Let me show you this in a second before we get to our actual preaching message. Is that all right? This is all introduction. All right, now look at Ephesians chapter 4. It says, and this is verse 9, it says, what does he ascended means except that he also descended to the lower earthly region? Who are you talking about here? He. Jesus, correct, okay? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers to prepare. Now listen to verse 12, all right? The reason for these. Because God, if you read before this, gave authority to these people, all right, to prepare God's people for the work of service. Can you ever say it? To prepare God's people for works of service. So the body of Christ may be, what? What does it say there? Edified, built up, all right? So we do service for one another so we can build each other up in the faith. Because why? Because we're going to give a message to the world. And what happened to Paul? He was persecuted. He was thrown in prison. He was beat. He was whipped. Some of the apostles lost their life. How can you do that unless you're built up in the faith? Amen? And that's what we're supposed to do. Build each other up in the faith. Until, say everything until.
Until.
We all reach unity. So we have to continue to build each other up in the faith so we reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. How many want to walk in the fullness of Christ?
Amen.
Come on. How many want to walk in the fullness of Christ in your life?
Yes.
The love of God, the peace of God, the grace of God. Amen. How many want to just do that? I mean, I want that. When I read that, I'm saying, I'm not quite there. Right? That's why we need each other. We all have different talents and skills. We all have different, come from different backgrounds. We want to continue to build a multicultural church. Why? Because people from different cultures bring stuff and understanding of God that I don't have. Amen? I never had to be persecuted, really, for Christ's sake. Not that much. A few times. But other cultures come in, and they come with a different understanding of who Christ is. I love that. I want to know that. It helps me grow in my faith. It helps me mature in understanding. And then it brings a true unity. Right? It brings a true unity to the body of Christ. Because now we're not saying let me say this right, because I don't want to reference this building as a church, okay? Understand, this is just a building, a house, where we worship in. Amen? We are the church. We are the body of Christ. We are the gathering. If you look up the word church, it means gathering. So we are the gathering, if you will. We gather together to worship God, to encourage each other in the faith, to strengthen each other in the faith, so we can do what God's called us to do, the service part. The reason I preface this, my whole sermon on this scripture verse, because what I'm going to talk about today is going to be a little bit hard. Is that okay? It's going to be a little bit difficult. I'm struggling with, you know, I just love everybody. I want everybody to be happy. Like I said, smile, you know. We're in church, we're happy, and it's a good place to be. But sometimes we need truth. Sometimes we need to be a little bit, and I'm going to preach Jesus. Let's go to Matthew 25. And let's go to, verse 1. These are Jesus' words. And I know that because they're read in my Bible. But more than that, if you read through the Gospels, I encourage you, if you're struggling with your relationship with Jesus or with God, would you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? All right? We just read the Gospels over. Remember, especially if we've been Christians for a while, kind of remember why we believed, why we first came to know Jesus, how that peace and that love took all that destruction, all the junk out of my life. In that moment when I said, yes, I recognize Jesus, Son of God, peace came into my life. And sometimes as believers, we're walking this thing out, and we're running this race, and it gets hard. And I just like to encourage you to go back. If you're in that situation, get yourself a Bible reading plan. Go on, what is it, Rajiv? It's YouVersion Bible. You can click on there because our church has a little thing. You can add to yourself to that. There's a reading plan there. There's just a lot of things that help us to systematically learn the Word of God. Or not just learn it, maybe just read it. Get that Word in us, right? And let it permeate our thinking and our thoughts and just our hearts and give us peace. And so it's just an important thing to be in the Word. So if you get a chance to do that, do that. But here in chapter 25, it says, let me just read this. At that time, the kingdom of heaven was like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take the oil, enough oil with them. The wise, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became dreary and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our oil is going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both of us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil, buy some for yourself." But while they were on their way to buy oil, the bridegroom arrived. The 10 virgins, the virgins who were ready, went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Go back again, verse 10. But while they were on their way to buy oil, the bridegroom arrived. The 10 virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, And the door was shut. Verse 11. Later, the others also came. Sir, sir, or some Bible says, Lord, Lord. They said, open the door for us. But he replied, I tell you the truth, I do not know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. Why is this verse so, this section so important? We read this the fourth or fifth sermon we've been out of the section. Remember I said a few weeks ago, I had this jar of my water jug, it's on my desk. And I carried it, and it was my oil. And I said this to you. I said, I can't give you my oil. Well, pastor's supposed to come and teach me. I'm supposed to learn from him. Everything I know comes from the past. No. I'm here to encourage you to continue to walk the walk for God. Amen? I'm going to take your hand if you need it. I'm going to walk you through the valley of the shadow of death if need be and show you the mountaintop you're supposed to be on. Amen? But I can't give you my oil. You got to go buy it for yourself. And you got to have enough. Come on, is that hard? Pastor, you're supposed to help me and help me grow. No. Listen, it says right here that there were some wise virgins and there were some unwise. And as I taught this, I said, so the virgins overall represent what? Somebody tell me.
The church.
The gathering. The believers. Am I right?
Amen.
You study it out. That's what it says. So in the church, in the gathering, there were some wise people, if you will, and there were some unwise people. The wise ones had enough oil. What does that mean? They were in the Word. They had the Spirit of God. Oil represents the Holy Spirit. So can you be a believer? Come on, I'm going to challenge your theology here right now. Can you be a believer and not have enough oil? It says, when I first believed, the Holy Spirit was deposited in me. So the Holy Spirit was in me, right? But then it says there's not enough oil. So I'm going to debunk the fact that once you're saved, can you always be saved? Some say yes and some say no. I got two scripture verses today that I tell you, I don't think so. Why? Because this story says you have to have oil.
Amen.
And there's a party coming. Who is the bridegroom in this story?
Jesus.
Right? Jesus is the bridegroom in this story. Jesus is coming back, is he not?
Yes.
Jesus was prophesying here about his return. He was telling the disciples, there are some people that are ready and some people are not ready. Right? Come on. And then he goes on to say, I know you guys are getting real quiet on me, but listen. Go study this out. This is one of those scriptures that I read over and over as a young believer and I never understood it. And I go back as I went through school and I wanted to understand it. I still didn't understand it. Why would he say at the end here that you had to go buy oil, and then when they came to the party, they were too late?
Amen.
Huh? We're going to talk about those virgins a little bit later on a different time. But it's saying that there's the virgins that were wise were able to go into the party.
Yeah.
Lord, Lord. But we prophesied in your name. We fed the poor in your name. We did this in your name. And he says, I never knew you.
Amen.
I don't want to be that person. I don't want to live my Christian life out doing all these wonderful things for the kingdom of God. And at that moment, it was because I didn't do it for him. I did it for myself. Or I just did it out of routine. I'm a Christian. I got to come to church. I got to do this. I got to get my tithes. I got to do whatever. I got to help people. And then it's just the routine. There's no power in it. There's no love in it. There's no. See, God wants us to walk in his power. Stand up like Peter did and prophesy and 3,000 people get saved. I don't know. I try that every day. It doesn't work for me. But there is a power to walk in. There is an anointing to be in. There is a glory to be walking through. So I'm thinking there are some believers that are like these unwise virgins. Am I wrong in that? Or, you know what I'm saying? Are we looking at this together?
Yeah.
Can we say that in this story, and these are God's son. This is, and Jesus only repeats what he hears from the Father.
Amen.
Come on. He only says the things that he hears from the Father. But here, I mean, I want to be at the party. I want to have a seat at the table. Amen?
Amen.
I believe Jesus went to go to prepare a place for you and me. I believe there's already a name peg at the table for every one of us.
Yes, amen.
Amen. It's already set. The table is ready. I don't think there's not much more to go on in this world, but you know, I think things are getting really close. He's going to call us forward, and we're going to go and sit at the party. And the bridegroom is going to come. There's going to be a sound like a trumpet that's going to sound. And in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, it says, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then those that believe, it says.
Amen.
How many believers I have here?
Amen.
Come on. Then it says, those that believe will be caught up together with him in the air. When is that going to happen? Nobody knows, because if you look, go back just the next chapter, chapter 24, it says the only one that knows is the Father, in verse 36 of 24. Who knows that time? Nobody knows. Why is that significant? Because everything that that Jesus did was amplified the Jewish wedding, our Jewish feast. So when a young man found a young lady that he wanted to marry, he would go to their family and give an amount of money or some animals or whatever, a dowry, and then at that moment they sign a contract, they'd be married. But they couldn't be together. Because the father wanted to make sure that he had prepared, the young man prepared a nice home for the bride. Jewish wedding, old school. When the father felt the house, the place was ready, then he would tell his son, okay, now you can go get the bride. And they would do that at night. They would go get the wedding party. So the bride was always kind of ready in the evening time. You know, they knew it was getting close. You know, she probably had her little spies out there. Is the house ready? Did they got the windows in yet? You know, did they get the carpet done? Has they got a dishwasher in there? You know, did they want to, you know, so she kind of knew when the time was coming. And Jesus said this, we wouldn't even know the season. You know the seasons. You can tell the difference when the trees are falling or when the fruit comes on the trees. So you're going to know when it's time for the father to come or for the bridegroom to come. We kind of can tell now, right?
Amen.
We can kind of tell. Things are getting crazy in the world, but God's moving everywhere. Everywhere. China and Russia. Thousands of people are getting saved daily. Amen? Europe. You see, you're all jumping to Europe. The Pentecostal church in Europe is on fire. There's people all over the world. South America, on fire. People getting saved. People being raised from the dead. Healing. All sorts of stuff are happening. Because of persecution and because of all the stuff that's going on in the world. It's getting close, folks. So I think when I look at Ephesians 4, that we need to mature. We need to understand the scriptures. And we can't understand the scriptures unless we read them. Because I'm not going to give you all knowledge of the scriptures. You know who's going to do that?
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit. Listen, most of my family is unsaved. And you're recording this so I can know that hopefully they'll hear this. My desire is that they know Jesus. They're so confused by religion. They're so confused about different messages. They just don't know right now. And all I want to do is share with them the love of God. But I have to be bold enough to say, hey, I love you and God loves you. And if you would just open this book and read, God will give you revelation. Amen. And I don't care what all the messages that you were taught and everything people have told you and the Jehovah's Witnesses come to your door and all that stuff that happens in the world. You can just put that aside if you just open this book. And it was the first time yesterday, or Friday, my brother-in-law says, well, what do I need to do?
Amen.
I was trying to contain it all. You know, I didn't want to just start shouting and jumping in their house because I know I'd scare them, you know.
Right.
They want to scare them, you know.
Right.
But I was so excited because remember when in Acts 3, it said, what do we need to do to get saved? It rang in my ears like, oh yeah, you are close now, you know.
Amen.
So I took them to the book of John. That's what I always do. I said, I want you to read about how much God loves you. Because we're taught we're so dirty, we're so ugly, we're so nasty, or our lives are so messed up, and we carry guilt all the time. And they do too. They don't need to feel that. Because God can take that away, because that's what he did to me. I said, reach out one. In the beginning was the Word. And who's the Word as you read on? Jesus. You can read about Jesus. You can know him. God, there's no secrets in God. There's nothing. How can a child understand this and then a scholar still be researching it? It's amazing. The uneducated and the educated can just go in here and receive understanding of how great and how wonderful the love of God is for this whole world. It amazes me. It amazes me that my sister, who's sitting in a hospital still, rehab hospital right now, never finished school, you name it, she's been through it. And I was able to share with her, I said, listen, Carla, I'm not mad at you. I'm not disappointed in you. I'm not happy you went through this. I said, God is here. He loves you. And he wants to help you through this process. And for the first time since I've been back to Wisconsin 9 years, she looked in my eyes and said, thank you. She received that. Amen? I could have beat her in the head. I could have told her she's no good. She's a sinner. I could have went to Romans, right? All have sinned and fell short of the glory of God. She already knows that. Yes. How do we know when we have sinned? Because the Holy Spirit is in the world.
Yes.
And that's his job, to convict and draw men to a saving knowledge of Jesus. What is our responsibility? God loves you in spite of all that junk.
Amen.
I'm thinking about a woman that had an abortion. She just was broken inside. Didn't think God would ever love her because of what happened. And understand that God can forgive everything. And the peace that came over her was just amazing. God wants to do that. And God wants to use us as servants. That's why the church has to mature. Because we're not just looking at ourselves anymore. We're looking at the world and loving on them and caring for them. Amen? In the process of helping people with the Word of God, you grow. Your faith begins to grow, and you get, okay, well, I'm going to go, I see that man in a wheelchair, you want to help him, but you know, we're all the same way, we're kind of like a little scared, especially if you're in public, what are people going to say? And you walk over there, and you lay your hands on him, and God heals his leg. Woo-hoo! Amen? And then you share with him, it's not me. Like Peter on the way to the temple, and John, silver and gold have I none, but such that I have, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Guess what happens? He rises up and walk, right? And what do they do immediately? No, it's not us. It's the Jesus that you guys crucified, the one that you put on the cross. That Jesus was raised on the third day from the dead. He's the one who did that.
Amen.
Folks, we need to be that way. Western way of thinking, the way church runs. Okay? We need to stop making church a business model.
Amen.
All right?
That's right.
That's what we're striving for here. We don't want that. We have business, right, Dion? We have business that has to be done. We have to do, you know, we have to make sure the money that's given is accounted for because we don't want to get sued, right? We want to make sure you get your giving record, all that stuff. All that has to be done properly. Every penny that is, if you ever want to look at our books, just ask Dion. He'll open up a computer. You can look at anything you want. There's no secrets here with that, okay? Right, Dan? It's just anything where it doesn't matter to me. It's not important. We're not have nothing to hide. You know what I'm saying? We want people to know that they're more than welcome to see what we're doing because that's just part of the business that we have to do in America, in this city. You have to do reports. You have to be accountable, right? And you have to have bylaws, blah blah blah. We do all that stuff. The most important thing is encouraging us to be mature Christians. To do what he's, the acts of service that he wants you to do. And everybody has different talents, and everybody can minister to different people. So, God wants to use all of us to reach every people group. Every people group. For his kingdom. Amen? So look at this verse again. Look at down here. It says this. Now, everybody's a Christian in the story of the virgins, right? Everybody's a believer. So then, some of them didn't have enough oil. Okay, this is what I'm going to talk about. Let's finish up with this. It says, but while they were on their way to buy oil, so they're going, they obviously know they can get the oil from somewhere.
Yes.
Come on. Yeah. Now, if they would have got the oil the day before, they would have been good. They would have been good. But they waited. Well, you know, it's not that bad. I don't really need to read my Bible today. I don't need to, you know, go help anybody. I'm just going to, you know, I'm a good person. I'm a good Christian. It's a lie. Don't believe the lie that the enemy has infiltrated into the church that we're okay. We're never okay. We always have to be learning. We always have to be growing. We always have to be giving. Our faith always grows.
Amen.
That's right.
Or diminishes when we don't get enough oil. I've been there. I know what it's like. Just kind of going through the motions for a while, you know, just doing things, you know, I'm not doing anything bad, you know, I'm not, you know, going out drinking, not, you know, crowding around on my wife, you know, I'm not doing all that stuff. I'm just doing good stuff. But that's where the oil gets drained out. I use up all that oil. All of a sudden, I stop thinking about the things of God. Pretty soon, I stop having compassion towards people. And I'm a compassionate person. So when I stop doing that, I went through that process. We all go through that. But we have to get and keep getting and keep filling up so we can give it away.
Amen.
So we can pour it in our lamps. Come on. Pour it in our lamps. And then our lamp will light. And when we put our lamps on a hill, what's it going to do? It's going to draw people to Jesus.
Amen.
How can you be so loving? Why are you so kind? Why did you stop to help me? I don't understand that. I was talking to one of our Chinese law students. And he was here for a men's Bible study. And he's kind of an upper class Chinese guy. You know, his family's well-to-do there. And he's going to law school. And we were, how long ago? It was a few years ago, two, three years ago. We were sitting, had a men's Bible study right over here. And we had tables and things for it. And we're doing a little Bible study, and we're in Matthew. And so asked him if he wanted a Bible. And he said, yes, I would like to have an English Bible. I said, okay, I have an English Bible. So he was looking at an English Bible. And he was trying to find his place and stuff like that. And I was watching him. Gave him time to kind of work it out for himself, but he just couldn't figure it out. And so I went over, helped him, showed him where we're at, you know, showed him scripture, and at the end of that Bible study, we just kind of had a little testimony. Everybody go around and share a little bit of what the scripture meant to them. And then we got to him. He says, I want to tell you something. In China, where he's from, people don't help people in China. Very selfish, he said. He said, for example, if I was driving down a road in my car, and he had a car, and I saw a car go off the road, he says, if I would get out of my car to go help that person, like push him off back out of the road. And he said, what would happen is that person, if the car got scratched, whatever, they would sue him. And he was there to help him. And the reason he said that is when I helped him with the Bible, he said, nobody would ever help me find the scripture or whatever. They just don't do that there. So pray for China. Pray for that the Chinese that come. There's many Chinese people coming to Jesus. Many professors right now. And scholars that are coming to the U.S. that are coming to know Jesus. Amazing. My son is at Purdue University, and the gentleman that he led to the Lord discipled him, now going back to China. His replacement happened to be another Chinese professor and his wife, and Rachel and Andy are befriending them, and so they have spent almost weekly there together having dinner, and now Andy's discipling them into not understanding who Jesus is. It takes work to be a Christian servant.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It takes work. I got all the stuff I have to do. I'm going to finish. When a few weeks ago I made this comment, I want to change the DNA of our church a little bit. Okay, I want to change how we think church should go. And I want you to finish with this thought. That everything you do, God has provided for you.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
If you have a job, God gave you that job.
Yes.
If you have a car, God gave you that car.
Amen.
If you have money to go to the university, God gave you that, right? If you have things, everything you have belongs to God. Ask Him. Is how we live.
Amen.
right? Everything, our, you know, when somebody needs it, we're, we don't have a lot of stuff. We have a few baskets downstairs, or bucket, or containers downstairs with the kids' stuff from grade school and elementary school, all over the world. That's all we have. We don't have a lot of stuff. Because I have a home that I'm looking forward to go to that's not here.
Amen.
Amen. So everything that we have and own and do is for God. That means the income that you have is God's provision for you to do ministry. Have you ever thought about it that way? I have an income. God's provided for me so I can do full-time ministry. Right? That we have to change our thinking. That's what the early church did. That's why they went and sold property and gave it to the apostles, sat it at the apostles' feet so they could just do the ministry. So people would come to know Jesus. It was different. See, it wasn't like our culture in America. It's just, it's different. We all are so selfish. We have our vehicles. We have our own car. We have, you know, it's like, you know, we don't even talk to our neighbors. Most of us don't even know who our neighbors are. We should. Because God put you in that neighborhood to lead those people to Jesus.
Amen.
And when you lead all those people to Jesus in that neighborhood, then you can move to another neighborhood. Come on. Wouldn't that be great? What if you live in an apartment building and you led everybody in the apartment building to Jesus, then move to the next one and win all those people to Jesus? That's what they did in Korea when Dr. Cho started his church. Everybody in those high-rises became Christians. They would help people. You know, because they don't have elevators, they had to just walk up steps. So they would, their young Christian men would, and young Christian ladies would help the older people with their groceries, and they'd carry them up for them up the steps. And as they're carrying them up, they'd tell them about Jesus, and they'd get saved. Amen? We can do that. We can do that. Because I want every one of you to be invited to the party. Amen?
Amen.
I want everybody to go to the party. Because it's going to be the best party ever.
Amen.
It says, don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. So being filled with the Holy Spirit, being drunk like wine, I don't know, but pretty close. Amen. When I worship and I praise God and then I can't walk out the church building, that's like, I guess that's being like drunk with wine. Is that okay?
Yeah.
How many know you're in a Pentecostal church right now?
Amen.
That means we believe in the Holy Spirit, right? We believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. We believe in the love of God, amen? And so sometimes it means that some of us can prophesy. When's the last time you ever heard in a church gathering tongues and interpretation? How many times? Ever hear that in a church service? Huh? Long time, right?
Yeah.
We can do that here. You have my permission, okay?
Amen.
All right, if you're out of order, I'll let you know. But for the most part, I can tell people, 99% of the time, you're actually speaking what God's put in your heart. But I'm not sure if I should say that or not. Just go ahead and say it. I believe God's trying to talk to all of us. He gave us spirit to walk in His power and His love. Not just to, just not to show up on Sunday morning. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So you shared a word a couple Wednesdays ago. That's why I shared this morning.
Amen.
I believe it's awesome. That was an awesome word. Because we've been praying that for years here. That this city is Hephzibah. Amen? That is the love. It's the apple of God's eye. And it'll be a light. So she shared, prophesied after her prayer on Wednesday night, you know, about Madison being a light for the nation. I said, yes, yes. Because it happened here in the natural just a few years ago when you had all the riots up on the Capitol. Madison, Wisconsin was all over the news. And now I think the next thing that's going to happen, Madison is going to be all over the news. It's going to be because the glory of God and people's lives are going to be changed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know, and I love, because a lot of young people now are looking for truth. And so a lot of fire, if you will, a lot of happening on the campuses around the world, around the nation right now. Because young people are tired of the junk of religion and are really seeking after God. Amen. We're seeing a fire across some of the campuses across America. That is cool. So it can be on fire in Madison, Wisconsin. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Can we sing that? Glory, glory, hallelujah. Or, like I said, we're looking for singers. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Let's lift up our hands. Let's get some oil today. Amen. Let's get some oil. Let's get some oil. Hallelujah. 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 You know, it's interesting in the story, too. So they went to purchase oil, and the oil is free. They're all messed up. Hallelujah. Oil's free. Oil's free. So just get some of that. Just get some. Come on, lift up your hands. Let's just worship Him and praise Him in your own language. Let Tino, Tino get that all working. Come on, we got to worship Him in our own spirit, in our own truth, in our own languages. Whatever God gave you as a spiritual language, just begin to worship Him and praise Him and thank Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.